So coming to outline of today's tutorial, first I would like to discuss about real numbers. Okay. Till now I am audible? Okay, fine. So coming to outline of today's tutorial, I would like to take problem which are based on completeness property. That means finding supremum and minimum and kind of approach. That means if you are having a bounded set, then definitely that if that set happens to be a subset of a real number, then you can with guarantee you can say that a bounded set has a if it is bounded above, then it is having a supremum. Or if that set is bounded below, then definitely that would have a infimum in real number. So that is the supremum, what we call it completeness property. And supremum and infimum I had already discussed a lot. And one more application of that we will discuss about in Archimedean property. It is really interesting in order to find limit of sequence. And in the similar version also series, you can put in the framework of sequence as well as a sequence of partial sums. And there also you can calculate limit of that sequence of partial sum, that would be what sum of the series. So those things would be very essential when you understand Archimedean property in a better way. It will give an analytic approach how to establish those results. Okay, after that I will talk about little bit mathematical statements and how logic is coming there in order to establish various results, and what are the logical operations which is helping in order to establish various mathematical statements and hence various theorem, and what is the proof technique kind of things. And before going to talk about proof technique, I will talk about quantifiers. So there are actually two kind of quantifier. One happens to be universal quantifier, for that in literal way we say that for every, and another one is existential quantifier, that we say that there exists at least one, there exists simply we are saying. And I will talk about negation of those things, because most of theorem are dealing with those kind of universal or existential quantifier. So it is very delicate to find the negation of that. So if negation is that negative of that mathematical statement. So if a mathematical statement is true, then negation of that would be always false. If a mathematical statement is false, then negative of that would be always true. So that kind of association you will see it here. So coming to first part, that problem from completeness property, how we can find a solution of those things. So various problems will come here. So I'm taking example first. What I told that in order to understand completeness property, just find supremum and infimum of a given set, where provided those exist, then you need to find those things. So how you can find those? So question is coming like that. I have taken various sets here. You have to find infimum and supremum provided those exist. If it is not existing, then we will say that doesn't exist. Okay, that criteria. If set is not bounded above, then we will simply say that there would be no supremum. It will go to infinity, positive infinity. If set is not bounded below, then simply we will say that that set is not having any infimum, because there is no lower bound. It will go to minus infinity. So that kind of situation. That's where this provided this what we call it. I have talking that if this exists, then we have to find it. If it is not existing, then there is no need to find. Okay. So I have taken all these examples. You just try to comment which one is bounded above and which one is bounded below among these three sets. Any idea? Just I have taken three sets, S1, S2 and S3. Anyone would like to say that which one is bounded above and which one is bounded below? Anyone? Am I audible? Okay, just then try to answer whether S1 is bounded above or not. S1 is what? It is a collection of all rational numbers whose square is what? Greater than 2. So definitely we can say that S1 is not bounded above. It is definitely bounded below, but it is not bounded above. So take a rational number, and do a squaring and try to see whether that a square of rational number is greater than 2 or not. If it is greater than 2, then it will come in this set, and if that a square of rational number happens to be less than 2, then that rational number will not come in S1. So simply we can say that it is bounded above. This first set is bounded below. So in short, I will write it bounded below. That means short word of bounded is B double D below. Or I can put a notation like this way. Downward notation, that means set is bounded below. And likewise, what about this? This one is also bounded below. Okay, but what about this? We directly can't say, we have to solve this inequality. This x less than 1 by x. After solving it, whatever that domain of x we will get, based on that we can comment whether it would be bounded below or bounded above. So okay, so we have to solve this. That is third question is little bit complicated. Now coming to the fourth question, that fourth set, it is S4, and talking about it is collection of all the numbers happens to be 1 by n, where n is a natural number. So again, tell me whether it is bounded above or bounded below. Anyone? Just first, whether say like yes or no, whether it is bounded above or not. I'm not getting any answer from your side. Anyone try to recall it? Whether it is that fourth set, whether it is bounded above or not? It is a tutorial. I need participation for yes. Yes, Chitish. And what about whether it would be bounded below or not? Yeah, very nice. So it is bounded above. Also, it is bounded below. Both things are coming. Okay, very fine. And later we will see that. First thing that we need to know whether it is bounded above or bounded below or not. After that, we will find supremum and infimum based on the information. Okay. Now come to third, fifth question, that S4, whether it is bounded above or not. Fifth one, S5. So like S4, definitely it would be bounded above, and also it would be bounded below. So we are having information about almost every set that having either bounded below or bounded above or both. Okay, but S3, I have removed it. I haven't discussed it because we need to solve this inequality. So I will talk about solving process later. So coming to first question, that once we come to know that S1 is bounded above, we'll talk about, S1 is bounded below, then we will talk about existence of infimum, that means the greatest lower bound, whether the S1 is having greatest lower bound or not. And just remember that definitely S1 is bounded below. Why? Because every member of S1 is greater than a square root of 2. So a square root of 2 is a, what we call it, a lower bound of S1. There is no issue. But S1 is not having infimum within Q. Why? Because S1 is a subset of rational number, and a square root of 2, it happens to be irrational number. No, it is not a rational number. So definitely we can say that S1 is not having greatest lower bound. Yes, sir? Any? Okay. So S1 is not having greatest lower bound. Definitely S1 is having lower bound. Various rationals would be lower bound, which are less than a square root of 2. Those would play the role of lower bound of S1. But a square root of 2 is the infimum. If you try to talk from the real perspective, a square root of 2 is the infimum of S1. But a square root of 2 is not in Q. It is not a rational number. So that's way we can simply say that S1 is not having infimum in Q. S1 is not having. Now come to second question. Second question is also, it looks similar to S2, but what is the issue here? We are taking members from real numbers. So that's why here S2, first it would be bounded below, then we will talk about infimum. So here clearly we can say that square root of 2, it is the largest lower bound of S2. Why? Because we can say that every member of S2 would be greater than equal to a square root of 2, and also a square root of 2 is a member of R. It is a real number. So we can say that S2 is having a infimum in R S2, but S1 is not having infimum in Q, but S2 is having infimum in R. So that is the difference between these two questions. Coming to third question, that we have to talk about whether this set is first bounded above or not. So we have to solve this inequality. So in order to solve this inequality, yesterday I think we might have already seen the how to solve this inequality. So it is very simple to solve. So here it is a what? Simple, there is no more absolute value kind of thing. Simply we need to simplify it. So take x left hand side, then just it becomes what? X square minus 1 less than 0. Or you can solve further. What is how you can factor further? So x square minus 1, it can be written as in the form of linear factor, x minus 1 into x plus 1 plus 1 less than 0. So you can directly solve it using order property. That means the product of two quantity is less than 0, then respective term would be of opposite side. So through two various cases you can solve it, but here this one is a tutorial. You can try yourself. I will just go through sine scheme approach that you had, you might have already gone through. So here, this, if you try to see this expression, it is having two roots. One is minus 1, another one is 1. So definitely, if you try to see the sign of this quadratic expression, so it would have this kind of sign. That means after 1, this expression is positive. Before minus 1, this expression is negative, positive, this, okay, because negative to negative positive, it would be like that situation. So here, what is happening that then between minus 1 and 1, this one is having a negative expression. So simply we can say that S3 is nothing, it is talking about a set which is containing real numbers between minus 1 and 1. It is a real number containing number between minus 1 and 1. So simply we can say that this set is bounded above by 1, also bounded below by minus 1. So it is bounded, S3 is a bounded set. If it is a bounded set, then we can talk about supremum and infimum of this set. So what is the supremum of the S3? What would be supremum? Definitely 1 is the upper bound. It is the upper bound of S3, but 1 is not in the given set. So it is the supremum, and 1 is the among these various, if you try to deviate a little bit by epsilon towards left, then definitely you will, that means you are deviating like this way. 1 is here. If you are deviating it by just 1 epsilon, it would be 1 minus epsilon. Definitely you will get various member of S4 between 1 minus epsilon and 1. So that's the way supremum of S3, it would be what? 1. And infimum of S3 would be what? Infimum of S3 would be minus 1. So S3 is having both supremum and infimum. Now come to S2, I had already discussed. Come to S4. So this set S4, as I told that it is bounded above and bounded below both. So you can easily observe that if you are taking a natural number is always greater than or equal to 1. We know that. That is the definition of natural number. And if you take 1 by n, then 1 by n, when n is approaching towards infinity, that means when n is very big, then where 1 by n will approach, it will approach towards 0. So that's why we can say that every member of S4 is bounded below by 0. So this S4 is bounded below by 4. It is a bounded below. Also, in likewise, also if you take n equal to 1, then it becomes 1. The largest member of S4 is 1. So and rest of member are less than 1. So we can say that S4 is also bounded above by 1. So if you try to claim that what is the, so we can simply say that x here, every member of x4 is greater than or equal to 0 and less than or equal to 1. Okay, so we can say that infimum of this set is 0, and what is the supremum? Supremum is 1. Apart from that, one more property you can observe it here, like 0. It is here, infimum is not in the set, it is not belonging to set S4, but 1 is belonging, that supremum is belonging to the set S. So what is happening, that if any of infimum, if supremum is in the set itself, that means every member of the set is less than equal to that supremum, and that supremum happens to be in the set itself, so we can give another name of that supremum. In this case, when it is also in the set, then we say that it is the maximum element or maximal element or largest element. There are various names. So you can also, if supremum belongs to, then we can say it is the maximal element, or every element is less than that element, maximum element of the set. So it becomes just another name. Okay, these are the example now. But what is the main situation is that how to get this, how to establish that 0 is the infimum and 1 is the supremum. So in order to establish, you need to know Archimedean property. So here I will discuss Archimedean property, and how to come up with in detail I will discuss it here. So what does Archimedean property say that? So it is a very famous kind of property. It is directly one application of that completeness property. Okay, what does it say? That it says that if you take any real number, then there is a guarantee that there exists a natural number n that would be upper bound x. Okay, so if you are taking any real number x, you don't know what is this real number. Okay, it may be any real number, then definitely there exists an associated natural number. Definitely we are saying that this natural number is implied from x. That's why we are giving a suffix n, x here. To this n we are giving a suffix n, such that we can say that the natural number, this x is less than n by less than nx, we can say that. If someone is taking very big real number or very small real number, definitely we will talk about existence of a natural number. So that is the Archimedean property, and how to prove this one. So here it is one kind of implication statement. What does it say? It says that this, if you call P hypothesis, then this would be what? Q. This one is the Q hypothesis, Q. So in order to prove this Archimedean property, just try to proceed with a contradiction. That means suppose that our conclusion is false. That is, what does it mean? If our conclusion is false, what does it mean? There is no natural number which is greater than x. What does it mean? Every natural number would be for a given real number. Due to this contradictory statement, we assume that every natural number is less than equal to x, the given real number. So simply it will imply that the set of natural number is bounded above. If set of natural number is bounded above, then it will guarantee that it is having a supremum, and that we denote it by U. That one is the supremum natural number. And we know from the characterization of supremum natural number, if you are taking an epsilon equal to 1, then what would be U minus 1? It would be no more than upper bound of natural number. That means there would be one, at least one member of natural number that we are calling it with epsilon we have taken equal to 1. So with respect to this epsilon, we are getting a natural number m, such that this m will fall between u happens to be supreme. We are assuming supremum, and we did a left shift of u by epsilon equal to 1. So between epsilon u minus 1 and u, definitely there exists at least one member of the natural number that we denoted by m, or you can call it n epsilon, we have taken it 1, n1. Okay, so we can say like this way. Now what is happening, that here a natural number is what? It is very close with respect to addition, so we are adding both side 1. So if you add here both side 1, what does it imply? It simply implies that this supremum u is less than m plus 1, and m plus 1 is again a member of, we know that if you are taking a natural number and we are, 1 is also a natural number, And addition is what natural number is closed with respect to addition. That means sum of any two natural number is again a natural number. So m plus 1 would be again a natural number. So from that we can see that m here we are getting a number, that one is m plus 1, which is greater than u. So it simply says that u can't be a supremum, u can't be a lower bound, because there is a one member of n which is greater than u. So here simply we can say that it is a contradictory statement. Why it is a contradictory statement? When we proceed with this statement, that q is false, when we proceed that q is false, then in that case we are leading towards a contradiction. So it is a contradiction, contradictory statement. So our what supposition we had taken, that one is wrong. Simply we will say that that assumption what we had taken, that our conclusion is false of this Archimedean property. So it is wrong. We can't say that. That means what does it mean? That definitely for the real number x, there must be at least one n that would be greater than or equal to x. So that's why it is always true. It is a proof. This proof is a proof by contradiction. We establish it that here I have already mentioned that u is not a supremum of n. If you proceed with this false conclusion, if you proceed with false conclusion, then your you will lead towards this contradiction, what we call it. Okay, so what we see here in Archimedean property, we told that for any real number, definitely there exists a natural number which would be greater than or equal to that real number. Okay, so similarly, if you take, because we are always using epsilon for a very small measure or epsilon neighborhood kind of things, so if you are taking a very small number, epsilon greater than or equal to zero, then it is a guarantee. So what will happen? So if epsilon is very a small number, then 1 by epsilon would be very big number. And we know that if epsilon is positive, then inverse of that one is also positive. That result we had already seen that. So if epsilon is a very small number, then 1 by epsilon would be a very big number. So with respect to that, if epsilon is greater than 0, then what we observe, 1 by epsilon is also greater than 0. It is positive. So with respect to this, definitely using the Archimedean property, we will get a natural number n that would be greater than 1 by epsilon. So it is directly coming from Archimedean property. And what is happening, that this same statement we can write it like this way. If you take n this end side, then for every epsilon we can say that we can get a natural number, so that 1 by n would be less than this epsilon, and 1 by n it would be definitely greater than or equal to 0. So greater than 0. So it is directly implied from Archimedean property. So using this concept, we can establish that if you are taking a set which is containing this kind of sequential element 1 by n, such that n is coming from natural number, then we can say that this set is what? It is bounded below. Every member is greater than or equal to 0. So it is bound very fine, bounded below. Now we will talk about existence of greatest lower bound. So how we can talk about? So from the Archimedean property, we had already seen that 1 by n is less than epsilon for every epsilon. For every epsilon, it is less than 1 by n is less than epsilon. Also, we know that 1 by n is greater than or equal to 0. So just recall one property that we had discussed during the order property. So if a number which is less than epsilon for every epsilon, what does it imply? It simply implies that it will say like this way. This 1 by n is a variable in nature. What is the fixed one? We have to always single out. It will simply say that infimum of the set would be between 0 and epsilon for every epsilon. Okay, so from here it simply implies that what is the infimum? Infimum is this set is 0. Here 1 by n is not fixed. 1 by n is variable in nature. What is the fixed quantity? Fixed quantity is infimum of the set, because every member of this set is greater than or equal to 0, and that and hence we can say that easily we can say that if you try to find infimum would be also greater than or equal to 0, and also we know that every member of this one is less than epsilon, so that's why NPMO would be less than epsilon. So from here it is true for every epsilon, and hence easily we can establish that actually if this statement is true for every epsilon, so we can claim that NPMO is equal to 0. So 0 is the NPMO of this set. So it is directly coming from that Archimedean property, what I told, that NPMO of this set is equal to 0. And there are various other results also you can establish all these are, that means if you are taking any real number, positive real number, then with respect to that there exists a natural number n, always there would be a natural number n, so that we can say that this given positive real number, it will falls between two conjugative natural number ny minus 1 and n, two conjugative. So always you can find that if you are taking any real number, like someone is saying that I am taking a real number 1.5, definitely it falls between 1 and 2. If you are taking, someone is taking 2.7, then 2.7 is what, it falls between 2 and 3. You take any number, any real number, any positive real number, then definitely that positive real number will fall between any two conjugative integers or positive integers or natural number. So that can be established with the help of Archimedean property. It is just one implication of Archimedean property. So it is all about today's problem based on what we call it Archimedean property. One more thing I would like to discuss is about here regarding the game with epsilon. Like same set, we are taking it s equal to 1 by n. Just as a homework, take it like this way. Also you can try it here right now. Suppose I am taking epsilon equal to 0.0011. Tell me, what would be the desired n that would be less than 1 by epsilon? Anyone, what would be n? How you can find n? Can you find? Just find the corresponding n, natural number. Yes, what? 91. What you do, just try to express this one in term of, you can express in this one in decimal form, you can express this one in the fractional form. So what would be this? 11 of 1000. It is not 1000, it is 10,000. 40 will come. So simply what you do, 11 of 1, so just you are getting just take reciprocal of that, take 900. Okay, so I am asking to find a natural number, I am not asking to find real number here, natural number you have to find it. Or better make things a little bit simple, it is not like that, it is directly coming through complicated result. So take epsilon equal to 0.1, so, start with basic one, so 0.1 would be more easier. If you are taking 0.1, so just learn how to find natural number. If you are taking 0.1, what would be natural number? Just 0.1, how you will write? You will write 1 by 10. Just, nice. You are getting 11. So 1 by epsilon would be what? Just check here, 1 by epsilon, it would be 10. It would be 10. So it would be definitely 10. Okay, 1 by epsilon. So here you can say that it would be, the 1 by epsilon would be less than 11. 11 is the unique natural number. If just take a little bit more complicated, if you take epsilon equal to 0.11, that means point 11 by what would be it?
2.
Okay, so from here we can easily check that 1 by epsilon would be, it is not a definite, it is a real number, it is not a natural number. So what would be a natural number? Less than 10, don't say like that, less than 10 simply. So what would be natural number which is just greater than this one? Just greater than. What would be that? Sure. Yeah, so with respect to this real number, you are getting a natural number. So all these are coming, all these are just computational framework of Archimedean principle, and this will help a lot in order to find limit of that. You can complicate things further, keep on, just try to play with this one. Simply like simply you can say, I would like to say that it is like this way. Someone is saying that infimum of this set is, this set is S, this same set, 0, infimum is 0. How can you say that 0 is the infimum? Definitely every member of element, every member of this set is greater than or equal to 0. So 0 is a lower bound of this set. It is a lower bound of this set, that is very much a guarantee. How can you justify your epsilon characterization? How you can justify your epsilon characterization? So suppose you are taking an epsilon equal to 0.1. Can you find a member of this set which would be between 0 minus epsilon and 0? Between this, can you find a member with respect to this epsilon? This here 0 is the lower bound, and if you just I'm writing it in wrong way, it is lower bound, so we try to find element between 0 and epsilon, 0 plus epsilon, 0 and, can you find a member of this set between 0 and 0 plus epsilon, so that it will say that 0 plus epsilon is no more a lower bound? Can you find, with respect to this epsilon, can you find a member of this set S? I have taken epsilon equal to 0.1. So what would be that member which lies between these two numbers, 0 and 0 plus epsilon? What would be that? That means we are trying to find S epsilon. What would be that F epsilon? That would be a member of this set. What would be S epsilon? Just at least one. There would be various member of this set. What would be S epsilon? No. Epsilon by 2 is... Listen here. The member of S is in the form of 1 by N. So try to come up with that form. 1 by 100. You are not concrete till now. It is very simple, just what you do, as I discussed here. So here we are having epsilon equal to 0.1. From here directly come to see the pattern of 1 by epsilon. So 1 by epsilon will, what? Epsilon equal to 0.1. What does it mean? It is saying that 1 by 10. 1 by 10. It is saying 1 by 10. Okay. So which member of this one is less than, what are those member which are less than 1 by 10? What are the member of S which are less than 1 by 10? Just talk about nearest one first, then you can go later. So 1/100 you can easily answer. There is blindly it would be, but just if you are just dealing in the just very small neighborhood of one this value epsilon, then that would be very good answer. So someone answer 1/11, so that one is a very good answer. 1/11, yeah. 1/10.5 can't be a member of this one. Simply 1/10.5, is it coming? 10.5 is not a natural number. Okay, so just nearest one is 1/11, then you can look for 1/12, then you can look for 1/13, then you can go for 1/100,000, as much as you want to move towards origin. Okay, so these are the members which falls in this interval. So simply we can say that 0 plus epsilon, it can't be a lower bound. Why? Because if we there are many various member of S falls in this interval between 0 and 0 plus epsilon. So with respect to this epsilon, if someone is changing another epsilon, if you take epsilon 0.001, much a smaller deviation of 0. So with respect to this, simply see the form first. What is meaning of 0.001? It is 1/100. So definitely what will happen here between 0 and 0 plus epsilon, you will contain various member of S. So various member of F. That means you are not allowed to deviate 0 towards right a little bit by epsilon, very as much as a small you can take it. So you are not allowed, because if you are allowing deviation of 0 towards right, then 0 would be the 0 plus epsilon would be no more a lower bound of the set S, and hence that's why we are saying that 0 is the largest among the several lower bound. 0 is the largest lower bound of S. So here also we can see that between 0 and 0 plus epsilon, what are the members? Who will say? 1/101, nearest one, and you can further proceed like that way. Take a smaller one, 1/102, 1/103, and 1/1000, 1/10,000, whatever you want to take. So those would be always here. So there are various members. You can see that there are various, with respect to this epsilon, we observe various member of this S between 0 and 0 plus epsilon. So that's why you are not allowed to deviate 0 by a towards right by a just small epsilon. With respect to that epsilon, definitely we will get at least one member of S that will say that 0 plus epsilon is not a lower bound of S. So that's why 0 is the great among, so there is no possibility of deviation. That's why 0 is the greatest lower bound. And hence we can say that minimum of S is 0. Now same question is coming with respect to another set. We are taking it S1. 1 minus 1/n, such that n is coming from natural number. What is the supremum of this set? You can play same epsilon game here. If simply we are claiming that definitely every member of this set is less than equal to 1. So we can say that it is bounded above by 1, and also apart from that, 1 is a upper bound of this one. Apart from that, we are saying that 1 is actually supremum of this one. Okay, so how we can justify that 1 is actually supremum of this set S1? So same characterization, epsilon characterization, we will take it here. We will take epsilon, 1 is here, and if you deviate 1 little bit by epsilon, that we are calling it 1 minus epsilon. So with respect to that epsilon, definitely we will get various member of what we call it, this set, various member of this set. So like take epsilon equal to 0.1. So what are the member of S1 which are between 1 minus epsilon and 1? So epsilon equal to 1/0.1, that means 1/10. 1/10. Okay, tell me what are those members which falls between these two? One by 9. Someone is saying 1/9. Check for 1/9. What would be this? What Is it greater than 1 by epsilon or less than 8 by 9? Just play with infinity. Is how 1 by 9 is definitely it is greater than 1 by 10. Okay. And if you take negative, then negative sign will change it. Forget about your knowledge about that things. It is a logical approach. So if you take just using order property, if you take a negative multiply with minus 1, the sign will change. And after that, what you observe? 1 minus 1 by 9 is behind this. There is no issue. So here till now also we can claim that what is this one? This one is 1 minus epsilon. 1 minus epsilon. Till now there is no what counter example which will counter that 1 minus epsilon is not a upper bound. It is there is no counter. So one if you proceed with 1 by 9, it is not a correct choice. What are those correct choice? 1 by 11. If you take 1 by 11, 1 minus 1 by 11. If you take 1 minus 1 by 11, then definitely it would be less than what would be here. It would be less, it would be greater than. You need to get a member of the set S which are greater than. Okay, you need to get, so sorry, yeah, this one was the set 1 minus 1 by n such that n is coming from natural number, and I had mentioned that set of this set is bounded above and hence it is having a supremum of this set, and supremum of this set is equal to 1. We had already seen that, and I was talking about deviation of this one is definitely a lower bound. Next our target is try to establish this one is this upper bound happens to be, and what supremum of S1. So our claim is this one. So that's why we are taking an epsilon like this way. Okay, that epsilon 0.1. So what does it mean? It means 1 by 10. 0.1 means 1 by 10. So if you take you have to find a few member of S1 which would be greater than 1 minus epsilon. So someone told that 1 minus 1 by n. Now 1 minus 1 by 9. So 1 minus 1 by 9, definitely that would be greater than, that would be less than this quantity. So that won't serve. So, but if you take 1 minus 1 by 11, what would happen? We know that 1 by 11 is less than 1 by 10. So if you take negative sign, if you take negative sign, both sides, infinity will change. So 1 by 11 would be, negative of 1 by 11 would be greater than negative of 1 by 10. And if you add 1 both sides, what does it becomes? We are getting that 1 minus 1 by 11 is greater than 1 minus 1 by 10. 1 minus 1 by 11 is what? This one is 1 minus epsilon. So simply you can say that this member 1 minus 1 by, it is a, definitely it is a member of S1 and it falls between 1 minus epsilon and 1. So it is just claiming that 1 minus epsilon can't be an upper bound of S1, and hence only candidate of the supremum it would be 1. 1 is the, among the various upper bound, 1 is the least upper bound. That means you are not allowed to deviate 1 towards left by any small epsilon, epsilon positive epsilon. You are not allowed to deviate. If you are deviating, definitely you will get some member of S1, some member of S1. So that is the visualization of supremum. So 1 is just a supremum. So you can get various, take on, keep on checking. You can play with epsilon equal to 0.01. Epsilon 0.001, You can take various epsilon. Depends upon your choice what epsilon you want to take, and try to find the corresponding. So this I am giving name up to this one. This one is S epsilon. So with respect to each epsilon, try to find a associated member of the set in order to come up with the idea that deviation is not allowed. That means one is the supremum. If you just deviate little bit towards left, then it would be no more a upper bound. 1 minus epsilon would be no more a upper bound, because you will get some member of the set. So that's why one is the supremum, and hence we can say that it is the unique upper bound which is, we are willing to get. We are just single out among the several upper bound, we are single out one upper bound. Okay, now this one is all a story of supremum, and also like I had discussed about infimum. Now here I will talk about mathematical statement. Okay, do we have time? I think it is already over. So other things we will discuss about in next class. Regarding attendance, just put your roll number there in comment box, and if anyone is having any question, you can ask.